Navy David said he's going to Oklahoma, so he's missing the whole week. But no, the other David I didn't hear from. But this is class 13, is that right?
Yes.
Today is April 19th. Let's get started with some review.
I would like to start off with saying I'm disappointed.
Kevin Sorbo.
Yeah. All right. So, no, I'm not really disappointed, but there wasn't much discussion about the game on chat, so whenever y'all want to iron out details on that, we can't go forward on some of the things y'all want to do until you iron out those details. So, we don't want to make the decisions for you is basically what it comes down to. So,
I was waiting for
channel.
Yeah.
There is a channel.
There is.
Mm-hmm.
You have to join it.
Yeah, you have to join it once. That's one of the things I don't like about Slack and why I think it's a horrible tool. But
you can invite people.
But in all seriousness, once you just go into it, you automatically subscribe to it. So it's yeah.
I was invited.
But no, just try to keep all the game discussion. You know, even though we're going to be doing some homework related stuff with the game, go ahead and put all the discussion for that in there. That way, we can keep it all in one place. That's going to be more of a public forum type project anyway. So. All right, so what did we discuss last time? What was the last thing we did in the Rails project?
It was, we were making that web page, or it was like through Rails, it was like the context.
Well, show them the answers, why don't you? I'm just messing with you.
No. I forgot you were looking at it.
Yeah, that's okay.
I'm doing the links in Rails.
Mm-hmm.
To other pages that we created.
Right, okay. What is a gem file?
It's a Ruby file that's you can auto install that has like.
Okay, that's close. It's not a Ruby script file, but it does contain instructions for the bundler. The bundler is, remember the gem when we say bundle install, that's our CLI to install different gems from the web, different packages. And the gem file is where all of our dependencies for our project go. Now, when we version lock or don't version lock a gem in our gem file, what keeps it from getting out of sync with our project? Talked about it briefly. Don't remember. Okay. Remember, there's a gem file lock that gets generated, and it contains the specific version locks for every dependency in the application and their dependencies. So that's really what keeps the project from moving to unsupported versions of applications if you have other developers coming on the team. Because when they do bundle install, they might see different versions of gems than you saw when you started the project. So the gem file lock says, okay, well, we've got specific versions locked in at this particular time. And when you actually do a bundle install, if there is a lock file, it goes off of that lock file and pulls down those specific versions. If you ever add anything to the gem file that's different, when you run bundle install, it checks to see if it's anything's missing from the lock file. If it is, it installs that one particular edition. So, I just ruined what bundler was. But, what is the difference between the SQLite gem and the Active Record gem that we include in our Rails gem file? Come on, David.
I know we're not supposed to use an SQLite whenever we do real stuff.
That's okay, real stuff for a, let's say, a Rails server project. SQLite's actually a production-worthy tool if you use it in conjunction with something like a mobile app, maybe. something that needs a small footprint database that's portable. You know, SQLite's a good solution for that, but for a web server application, it doesn't scale very well.
But that doesn't answer your question.
No, it doesn't. Anybody else? SQLite versus Active Record? Okay. Yeah. Oh, were you about to say something?
Uh-uh.
Oh, man. Got my hopes up. I saw that look. I'm like, okay, yes.
Nope.
All right. Active Record's our ORM gem, right? What does ORM mean? Oh, you guys are killing me tonight.
I know this. I can't remember.
Something that happened.
Mapper. But yes.
Something
yes.
Object relation mapper?
Yeah.
Yes, object relational mapper. Okay. Active Record's our ORM, our object relational mapper. So if it's our mapper, what is the SQLite gem to it? It's the adapter, right, that tells it how to talk to the SQLite database. So remember we said when we eventually changed using Postgres a different type of server, we're going to swap that gem out for the Postgres gem? That's the adapter, okay? Now, up there, in an ERB file, what's the difference between that and that? Okay, the code in both is evaluated, right? Because it's Ruby that runs, okay?
The bottom one is if you want to print it.
The bottom one is, right, the bottom one's if you want the result of whatever is evaluated to be put on the screen. So, what types of files are these? They're HTML files, but specifically what type of HTML files are they that they can run Ruby?
Embedded Ruby,
right. Okay. Let's see, we talked about loops last time in ERB. We showed how we could loop over collections in our HTML views to render stuff to the pages, right? We talked briefly about assets. What are assets? Elaborate on stuff.
It's going to be like your images and your JavaScript files and your style sheets.
Style sheets, good notes.
Yeah.
I saw the eyes. All right. You want to bring up the homework?
Yeah.
And while he's doing that, what is MVC?
What's what?
MVC.
Model View Controller.
Right, that's an important one. Because that's what Rails is, right? It's an MVC framework.
Did y'all put this on Slack?
What? I don't think we did because it was kind of a repeat of the other assignment.
Man.
We basically just said put
I'm
it
slacking,
in a Rails
I'm sorry.
Application. You know?
I forgot.
You forgot there was homework?
Well, I did five.
Oh, on the tutorial?
Oh, okay. Alright, I'm going to kill the light here for a second. Alright. So, the basic assignment was that we wanted you to make a Rails application that was essentially kind of like the plain HTML app, little website that you had done before in standard text files. We wanted you to have a few different pages that you could link back and forth. You know, you have your home page and maybe an about page, stuff like that. Now, where'd it go?
Hang on, man.
All right. Okay, so if you go to the routes file, if you would config routes.
Yeah.
what's wrong with this?
Deborah, we're picking on you.
I see.
Okay. You're the only one that did the homework.
I'm the one that helped
Yeah.
Well, what's wrong with that? Well, we talked about it. It runs, don't get me wrong. There's nothing syntactically incorrect about it, but what's not ideal about this scenario, this route structure? What does the left side of the slash here mean?
That's if you refers to where in like the where it goes in like the model or like the back end of the application. Like
the left side of this is the controller name. The right side is the action on that controller. Okay? So, we actually have three controllers here, alright? All of which have about actions inside of them. Okay? Probably the more standard way of doing this would be to have one controller that had multiple actions. So maybe have home about, home index, home slash links, something like that. And then you could share the same assets files because you have assets associated with your controllers. We'll be going over that tonight. So that's really all on this file. Go into the views over here. Yeah. So we have a different view for each of these controllers, right? All of them are about pages. They all actually work. You can navigate to them, right? But what's the main problem with this? The whole thing. Like, look at the big picture.
Would you put all that in an asset file?
Okay, well, so the styles should probably go in a style sheet somewhere, right? All right. What else? There's a bigger one. It's right at the top. Okay, maybe not exactly at the top.
Swinging a miss.
All right, well, we start and open a new HTML tag here and a new head tag. We provide the title and all that kind of stuff, right? What page are we looking at? We're looking at the about page for this controller, correct? All right, well, what happens in our shared layout here, this application.html? Oh, go ahead and open it up. Yeah. You see, we're already defining an HTML page and a head here. And then remember we talked about yield? What does yield do in this context? Whatever page we're looking at gets rendered in this spot, in this space where yield is defined, right? So all of these examples, all of these about pages, render entire HTML tags, whole other pages inside of pages. So it's a full HTML. So here's one HTML file in a head, tag in a head. Here's the second one, and it's inside of the body. That's not standardized. Okay, that would actually cause some problems, especially if we had specific assets attached to specific controllers. We don't have that yet, but we will. Okay, so what should have been in the in one of these layout files? Okay, scroll down.
Well, you can see this kind of picture.
So, all of this is information that could go in the body, correct? So, that all could stay, but the JavaScript, the CSS, all that probably should have gone under assets, and there shouldn't be a body or an HTML tag anywhere inside of these views unless they're layouts. Okay? Your layouts are shared between your different controller views. Alright? Is there anything else we wanted to touch on in this more? I don't think so. I think that was it.
All right.
All right, so
that's the wrong one.
Wrong what?
Sortable list. That's not the right thing.
What are you looking for? I think this is just one that I already have.
Oh, okay. Where's the product? Gotcha. Damn, when did we do that assignment?
I have lots of them open. Did you know that?
It's talent.
It's something.
All right. Before we dig in too deep, what is the difference between a get action and a post action? This is going back a few weeks ago when we were talking about REST paradigm, remember?
They both will get ready.
You want to switch? It's not the best chair.
Right. Whatever you say.
Does this have to do with credit?
Not really, not specifically. Okay, well, let's look at our routes file. This is the project we started last week, right? The contacts little web application. What do we see here in our routes file? How many routes do we see defined total?
Three.
Right, because the root counts as one, right? Okay, so if I go down here and I do rake routes, three print out, correct? Remember, that's an easy way of dumping the routes. So when I say a get action, I'm talking about the verb for that particular resource, right? So what do all of those have in common with regards to the request type that we're making? They're all fetching a page, right? They're all retrieving that information for me. It's a get. I'm getting something. I'm saying, bring me back, get me the resource at this URL, right? Okay. So what is a post? It pushes information to the server. Right. Now we have two different types of actions that push information to the server, right? What was the other one? Post was one. What was the other?
Fetch.
Mm-mm. Pushing information.
It's not push, is it?
No, but it starts with a P. Okay, I'll take patch. Pat, remember patch and put? Those two, they kind of go in conjunction with one another in Rails. So, now, with regards to CRUD, just for fun, which of those actions correspond to which CRUD action? A get is a what?
Create.
Mm.
Read.
A get is a read. I mean, a get, you're getting something, you're reading something, right? Okay, we just said post was pushing data, right? So what do you think post is? We talked about it before. Post was something and put and patch was something else. Is post create or update?
I think it's update.
All right, it's create. Put and patch were update, right? Okay, think of patch. When you're patching something, you're updating something, right? When you're posting something new somewhere. You're posting it for the first time. Okay? Think of that terminology. That'll help a little bit. So, there's one other thing in CRUD, right? There's the delete, right? Mm-hmm. Okay, there's the, so what action do we have for that?
Destroy.
Well, we hit, okay, I said action. If you've done any scaffolding, you'll know that the Rails action that it puts on the controller is actually called destroy, but what's the verb, the request verb? It does start with a D, but there's not many guesses. I mean, it's
delete.
Yeah, that's pretty straightforward. We don't try to make these things complicated. We take the low hanging fruit most of the time. So, all right. So, if I put in here, let's say I wanted a post action to create contacts, what's the RESTful route I would want to design for that? You remember the REST examples that we did? So without worrying about the syntax, tell me what the route would be.
Post.
Okay, it's a post. That's the verb. What's the rest of the resource? We're creating a contact, right? We're adding one to a collection.
Post contacts.
So that would be the route, right? That would go in the URL. So what's the corresponding route we need to add in here? The post part can actually stay.
It's not index.
It's not index. Index is what? Index shows us the index. That shows us the list of them. That's why that's a get there, get contacts index, right? Well, we're doing a create, right? So let's call it create. Let's call it what it is, right? Now, if I were to leave this here, okay, I can run my rake routes as long as they haven't changed it in versions, okay? And we can look at that resource. We see that we now have a prefix path for contacts create, the post verb, and there's our route. And look at the controller in action mapping. So if I actually wanted to implement this route, okay, what am I still missing? We just added the route. There's a few other pieces we're missing, right? We've done this many times before. Okay, I need a controller. So, based on this route, what controller do I need? No, what kind of controller do I need? Well, what's the left side of the route mean? It says it right here in rake route, in rake routes. The left side is the controller, the right side is the action, right? So for this route, what kind of controller do I need?
A contacts create.
A contacts controller. I don't need a contacts create controller, I need a contacts controller. Creates the action, right?
Right. Don't we have one of those?
We have a contacts controller. That's right. It's already got an index action in here, correct? So if I wanted to add the create action, what would I do?
Make a new method.
Okay.
Create.
Correct. And I would put all of my code to create that contact in here, wouldn't I? Okay. Let's leave that off for now. We'll spend a little more time in the routes file. Okay. What are all the types of routes that Rails calls Rails REST? You can give me the action names. You don't have to give me the verbs. We've talked about all of them. We just talked about two. There's index and create. What's the other three? You don't have to worry about the delete one. Mm-mm.
Root one?
Huh?
It's root one?
Root is not one.
Well, that's...
Okay, do you remember,
is add one?
Add is not one, John Mason.
Just create one.
Create is one. Yeah. So, remember we had new, we had create, we had update, we had edit, and I told you not to really worry about this one, but I'll go ahead and put it here because I want to talk about that one especially here in a minute. But these four right here are our other Rails RESTful actions, okay? Now, only two of them out of those additional four are standard REST actions, and that's the create and the update. The two odd ones out are new and edit. But why do we need those in Rails? We talked about it before. Remember the first class we went over a Rails application, we talked about it. Yeah, why do I need a new if I have a create? Why do I need an update if I have an edit?
Because then you're editing the update.
No. Somebody has not done their Rails homework. All right, so the new action here, what type of action is that? Is that a get, a post, or a put? It's a get, right? What does it do for us? It brings us to the page where we're going to create a new contact. All right? So these two extra ones are get actions that bring us to the pages that allow us to fill in the data we want to submit. The create and the update actions are the actions that fire when we actually submit that data. Okay? Tonight we're going to talk a little bit about how we submit that data. And it's using HTML forms, okay?
What about show?
Okay, we didn't, show is just a get like index. The only difference is it returns a single item. Can you tell me, we can go ahead and write that one without any extra logic, right? What do I put here?
At contacts.
At contacts? Big contact. That's the class, right? The contact class.
Find.
You are so reading this off of something, aren't you?
The homework idea.
It's still wrong.
Work for the homework.
It's not wrong functionally, but.
Parentheses, params.
Nah, I'm just gonna do that.
Bracket ID.
Yeah. That's not returning contacts, though, is it? Is it? It's returning a single contact, isn't it? So we would want to call it that because that's what we're going to have to refer to it as in our view.
See that in my notes now.
Yeah. All right, so it shows pretty easy, but we can't actually hit that action, can we? Why not? Let's take this out. Let's save our files. Okay, start our server. Okay, this shows all of our contacts, right? What's the route to show something? What route do I need to show a specific contact? I probably don't have one. What would it be? Just so that we have a goal in mind, what would it be?
Contacts.show.
In the URL?
Slash show.
Slash show? You sure?
Nope. I'm going with it.
Contact all?
Mm-mm.
You're looking at one contact, right?
Oh, one
contact.
Contact. Remember we talked about this when we were discussing databases, right? How does it know which contact to get?
Each one has a unique.
Tell it what location.
I have to tell it the location, right? So if I want the first contact, I say give me the contact /1. If I want the one with this ID 2, I say /2, right? So that would be the route, but like you said, we don't have one. We probably need one, right? So how do I do that?
Would that be a view, or do we have to make it in the routes?
Do I?
Do we need a view, or would we make it in the routes?
Well, we kind of need both, don't we? We need a view and we need a route.
That's what was confusing about the homework. I see what it did.
You need all three pieces, right? You need the controller action, the view, and the route.
I'm not sure it's going to work.
What's up? The wrong chip.
Resources. And that would be.
When you say resources, do you mean this guy?
Yeah. I get real confused when to put the colon. When to space colon or when to colon space. Or sometimes you colon space colon.
Well, they're two completely different things, right?
Yes.
Alright, so remember I said that. I would only show you the colon space technique if it didn't confuse you.
Yes.
You all agree to these terms.
All right,
so if I have this, okay, colon, no. What is that called? Just by itself, in Ruby. It only exists in Ruby, remember? I'm looking at you.
It's not known. There's other people here.
It's not an attribute, is it?
It's not an attribute, no. It's not within a class or an object, right? It can be an attribute. It's a symbol, right? Okay. So you're asking, well, what's the difference between that and something like that? Right? Okay. What is this if I draw all these? That's a hash, right? So in a hash, what is this?
It's an object in the hash.
It's the
no, just this guy.
Key.
Not, okay.
Key.
That's the key. And what is that?
The value.
The value, right? Now when we first learned about hashes, what was the original syntax to write those?
Hash rockets.
Right. So it was this, right? We had that, correct? We were saying the value of the symbol num was 2. Okay? This is just the symbol num. When you say colon space, these two are equivalent. Okay? Rails does this for you. That's why I wanted to teach you this way first. And this is the way I really want you to understand. This way will not work for you anywhere outside of Rails. In plain Ruby, will not work. It will give you syntax errors all day. Okay? But the reason I kind of wanted to go ahead and show it to you is because Rails doesn't care that it's confusing. It uses this all over the place.
Yes, it does.
So you have to know when you see this colon, it unfolds to this. Okay? This is the same as this. Alright? It's always one-to-one this way. Okay? Now, you can have hashes in Ruby or in Rails that have keys that are not symbols, right? Mm-hmm. This is just where the keys are symbols. We could have keys where the keys were integers or they were strings, right? Remember, we did that in several of our assignments. Okay? But this syntax, it's very clean. It's the most idiomatic with regards to what it looks like in other languages. But it unfolds to a symbol. Okay? So, when I say resources, context right there, like you were saying in homework, what is context? That's a symbol, right? What is resources? I want you to say function.
Function.
It's a function, right? We haven't talked about it. That's why I gave you the answer. But
that.
Yeah.
So that, like, I made a folder in Vue called articles in the homework, the other homework.
Okay.
So when I call resources articles, I'm calling that folder, or that symbol equates to that.
The reason why I was actually sticking in this file is because I wanted to talk about resources. So we'll talk about specifically what that means here right now.
So notice that we're writing all
these. Can I see the context folder? Can I see the context folder? Show the folder. Real quick.
Yeah.
Sorry, tab open.
Oh. This guy?
You mean the context controller?
Yeah.
That's all right.
To
everyone else is confused.
The Rails learning curve is ridiculous. I know it's frustrating, but the more that you, like, seriously, when I first started learning Rails, probably the first week of playing with it was me starting new projects over and over and over and just trying different things, because it takes a while to really get to know what all's going on. There's no way to explain all the magic that goes on behind the scenes until you really see it. You know, that's one reason why in your homework assignments I don't want you to use generators. I want you to write the stuff by hand. You got what you need?
Good.
Yeah, good.
Okay, good. All right, so if you notice, what we've been doing up to this point is we've been writing down our routes one at a time, right? So if I wanted to, let's pretend like I was writing the full RESTful Rails stack of routes out for a context controller. I'm missing a few routes, right? We just added one for show, okay? Well, what's another one that I'm missing? New, right? New, okay? What is new? New is a get, correct? Okay. We have the create. I think you said we need the update. We need the edit, right? So we can actually get to the edit screen. Oops. And then we have the delete action, which is the kind of weird one, but it points at destroy. That's a lot of writing just to write down these simple routes, correct? Now, if I come down here and I stop my server and I say rake routes, it shows them all as defined, right? So we have our home about that was defined earlier, but now we have all of the routes for our context controller. We don't have the actions filled in or actually implemented in the context controller. These are the routes. This is basically saying, the routes file basically draws lines saying if I get a request that looks like this,
send it here. Okay? So it's saying if I get a request that matches this pattern, send it here. If I get one that matches this pattern, send it here. Okay? But that's a lot of writing. The alternative was what you brought up, which was saying resources, contacts. You cannot always use this, all right? But if you do, it makes all of this go away. Save a lot of time and a lot of writing. Now, from doing the homework assignment, do you know when it's applicable? Okay. That's okay. It's a little weird. But if I say rake routes here, okay, I have a route for every one of those actions that I defined up here. Now, what's the primary difference you see between the two? The two sets. Sorry, not the ones I pointed to, but the two whole sets. There is, but it's because they separate patch and put. That's all. They go to the same. There's what?
Blanks.
Right here, you're talking about? Yeah. We'll talk about why later. But what's the other difference? I'm talking about the URI pattern. Look right here. Look right there.
ID.
Okay. You see, you can define your custom routes to do whatever the heck you want by hand. Okay? You can make them look like anything. But if you are okay with following the RESTful defaults that Rails puts forward, then you can use resources and it will give you these predetermined routes.
It did say that.
Huh?
It did say that.
Yeah. Now we still have our new, we still have our edit, but this ID here, we've used that in our show, right? Okay? So anything you see defined with a colon ID or a colon whatever, that's a symbol in the string, okay? But what that means is you can access it with the params hash inside of your controller, okay? We call this a URL parameter, all right? It's a parameter we didn't have to submit a form to supply, but we need the information anyway, and it's provided directly in the route. Okay? So, we wired in our show route, correct? I've only got two here, though, and this is a lot of routes to only have just those two actions available, correct? So, do you think that slows Rails down at all? Maybe just a little. This is just one stack of contacts. Imagine something like, some rudimentary inventory software somewhere. It's easy to get up into 150, 200 routes before the project's really even done. Okay? Whenever a request comes in, it has to probably look through all these to see what pattern matches and then go down that tree, correct? So the less of them that are available, the quicker it will be, right? So there's an easy way to get rid of the ones that we don't need, even if we're using the resources contacts, okay? And the way to do that is by saying except. We can say except for, let's say the only one we wanted to leave out was destroy, okay? Then if I did that, it would remove the destroy action. But I'd have to leave out a lot in this case, right? So I'm going to do the opposite of that, and I'm going to say only do the index and the show actions. Okay? Now if I come back down here to rake routes again, you will use rake routes a lot.
Uh-huh. So if you want to use Rails as predetermined,
mm-hmm.
You would use resources generally?
Generally speaking. And in fact, Most of the time, because it does follow such tight REST conventions, that's pretty well what you want anyway. Now that's assuming you're using, or wanting to design, rather, a REST interface. Okay? Remember we talked about other paradigms that are out there for web-based communication, like SOAP, but we're not going to go into detail on those in this class. One, because Rails doesn't like them and it will be mad at you. But REST is very well adopted into the Rails system. Mm-hmm. We're about to get to the fun part. We get to see it. You good?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So I'm going to close a couple of these files. Here's our index file, right? Our index.html.erb file. Now, when our server is running, when I go to our contact screen, okay. That's what I get, right? Just a generic list of contact names, right? Now, this code is what's being evaluated to generate those. I have my header tag. I have a horizontal rule. I make an unordered list. All that's standard HTML. But then I have my embedded Ruby code here, which loops through each of the contacts.
Where's the index file?
This is the index HTML. It's under views, and it's under contacts, right there.
All right.
You remember this folder structure is important in your views folder, because what it does is it says I'm going to look for the folder name that matches the name of my controller. We have a contacts controller, so it looks for the contacts folder. It's the index action, so it looks for the index page. And all that's that weird Voodoo Rails magic. Okay? Because we're not specifying that anywhere, are we? Okay. So if I want to go to, let's say, that show action, I want to use that show action, okay? I say contact/1. I get a different error message this time, right? We have our route now. It's not our no route found or anything like that. It found the route. It's saying, all right, well, I'm missing a template. So, what do you think I ought to do? I ought to make the template. What needs to be the name of the template?
Show.
Right. Because it matters. Okay. To show html.erb. I think I accidentally collapsed that, but yeah. Alright. I'll go ahead and wrong system. Okay. Actually, I don't even need this. Okay. Let's just say I wanted to put the contact's name there. How would I do that?
What are you looping over?
A full list.
Why do I need to loop over the list? What do I have inside the show action here, the show method? I have a contact, right? I have a single contact. I've already found the contact I'm looking for, right? The only reason we had to loop through them in the index page is because we wanted to show all of them on the index page. I don't need to do that here. I'm just trying to show the name of the single contact we found, right? So how do I do that? I need some Ruby code, probably.
Oh.
So, we'll start right here, and I'll let you tell me how to fill in the rest.
Do you need the equal sign?
Do I?
Do you not need the equal sign?
I want you to answer that question.
I feel like you do, but you already went over.
All right.
So that makes me think you don't.
I wanted you to catch me.
He forgot. That's what happened.
Yeah, I forgot. What else? I need to run some Ruby code, right? What Ruby code do I need to run? Okay. Think about it this way. If I'm right here, I have this contact already, right? How would I show its name if I were just doing this in code? Let's say I wanted to print it to the console. Right here. How would I do that? Puts, okay.
At contact.
Not show.
No.
No, not show.
What's the method that we wrote? We wrote it on here, right? To show.
Well, who remembers that? Full name.
It was your project.
That was like a week ago.
Okay, so full name, but I could have done it with first name or last name if I just wanted to show a part, right? Mm-hmm. But I made this method so that I wouldn't have to keep combining them into a string, right? So I could say puts contact full name right there, and that would print it out to the console, right? I don't want to print it out to the console though, do I? I want to put it on the page. So if I want to put it on the page, what code do I need to run in the page?
Honestly, it's
that,
but
okay.
But now I'm hesitant.
Right? That's all I need. Now I better get rid of this, but.
And that equal sign is basically a puts.
Close this guy.
Probably not, but.
Well, without it, nothing would ever be added to your HTML.
Okay.
Would it be for us okay for me to think about it like that at this point in our Ruby on Rails career?
No. Now, if it helps you, you could kind of think of it that way, but you're going to run into like issues where that kind of ideology isn't going to make sense. The way you kind of need to think about this is a template, right? Let's go to one that's a little bit bigger. This is a template, right? Okay, when the request for the index page is made, it starts down in the route, right? Okay, it starts in the routes file. It's trying to decide where to send it. So we have our config file, our routes file here, okay? It goes, okay, I have a route for a contacts index. I can do that. Where do I need to send it? Well, I need to send it to the contacts controller in the index action, right? That's what my rake routes tells me, right? So I go into the contacts controller and I run the code for the index action. Well, that goes and fetches all my accounts and assigns them to an instance variable called contacts. We know that. And then Rails does this confusing little magic stuff that we kind of have a love-hate relationship with. And it says, all right, I'm called the contacts controller. I'm running inside the index action. You're not specifically telling me what page to render, so I'm going to try to figure it out for myself. So it looks inside the views folder. It looks inside the contacts folder, and it finds index.html.erb. Before this page is sent to the browser, it runs this page and executes all of the code that's on it, that's Ruby. That code is evaluated then, and that equal sign there means, hey, put the value of that evaluation here, And so your HTML page is completely pure HTML before it sends it to the browser. Okay? So anything inside of these braces here is Ruby code that's going to be evaluated. But providing that equal sign says, I want the value that results from this Ruby code to be placed inside the HTML explicitly when it's sent back to the user. Okay? So it differs from puts a little bit. Okay. Now I've provided my code here to show this this contact's full name, right? So if I refresh, there's me. If I change it to 2, there's John. If I go back, there's our full list, right?
Can I double check the contact.rb file?
Yeah.
So there's something going on there.
Right, sweet. You got some errors over there?
No, I've never got this one down.
So everybody's got this now, right? No, got it. Got it up here.
We know
got
what's
it.
Going on.
Yeah, you know what's going on, right?
Right.
Y'all are making me feel so confident.
We're getting it.
I know. I'm just giving you a hard time. Y'all are doing good. About to do something new. And really, the only way that you, I keep saying this, but it's because it's the truth. The only way you're going to get this is by doing it over and over and over until you see the errors that come out of it and you adjust, you know, because then the light bulbs start to click. That's why that happens, you know, so. But with Rails especially, repetition is going to be your best friend. And it doesn't matter if you can make a standard HTML site. Doing an HTML web application in Rails is very, very different, even if you're not dealing with a database. And it's because you can't just relate to relative file paths. You know, you've got to go through this routing structure that goes up through controllers and then renders partial views, and it's not simple. It's not.
What's the action for show?
Show.
The
verb?
Yeah, the verb.
Get. Remember, you're retrieving. Okay? Anytime you're retrieving data, 99% of the time, it's going to be a get. Okay. It doesn't matter whether you're going to Google, whether you're talking to an HTML page or anything like that. If you're going to a site, if you're going to a page, 99% of the time, it's a get action. The other 1% of the time, the developer decided to do something very edge case. Is there something wrong? No? Okay. Cool. All right, so next part. Now, before we go forward, I want to make sure everyone has specifically these three things. They have a resources call here in their routes file. Okay. They have a contacts controller with two actions in it, and they have corresponding views for those actions. Do we have those things? Okay, that's fine. The we have the resources declaration inside the routes file. Let me double click these so they stay open. We have the controller with the two actions, and then we have our views, right? Our two views. We have an index and a show. That guy? What we're about to do is we're about to add a, we're essentially going to add two more routes. Okay? We're going to keep expanding on this. And we're going to, by hand, write the routes required to create a contact through the browser. Because these two, remember, we created through the prior console. Nobody on Earth is going to do that. That's ridiculous. It's happened before, but it's ridiculous. Anybody using our web application is going to need something like that. So before we get started, immediately, what routes do we need? We just talked about them. Come on, David.
I don't want to be the only one answering all the questions.
I want you to be the only one answering all the questions. All
right, repeat.
It's a lot quieter without Navy Dave.
He answers every question.
He does.
Usually he's there for support.
He's fearless.
All right, repeat the instructions.
There were no instructions.
Yeah, whatever you just said. Find the problem.
I said... I said, we're about to add routes to create new contacts in our system.
Yes.
Okay? Given what we just talked about regarding routes, I need to add two. What two are they?
New.
Okay.
Create.
New and what?
Create.
New and create. Okay? So,
I'm ready for this. Let's do it.
That's right. You are ready for this.
Comma.
Let's start with one at a time. Okay, let's add them one at a time. So which one do I need first? Do I need new or do I need create?
New.
That's right. You're doing good, man. Okay. So inside our routes list, add comma new to your list of routes that you want from the resources. Okay? Everybody got that? Okay. In our contacts controller, this will be, whew, this is going to be a difficult method to write, right?
Def.
New. What else do we need?
Already did the end.
What else do we need? We don't need anything there, right?
Correct.
We're just returning a page. Okay. We could put something there if we wanted to explicitly return some weird page or check some conditions. One standard use case that is valid is that, okay, before we return this page, let's make sure the user's logged in. You know, you don't want to let someone past who's not logged. People who aren't logged in shouldn't be adding stuff to your system.
Why would you not?
Because we're not there yet.
Oh, sorry.
Did they fix the hole in the ceiling when it started to rain?
I think they did patch it, yeah. Yeah, we that wasn't a hole. The one we had over there was a hole. We had a bad one. We're still missing a few ceiling tiles. Alright, so I'm done here for now, right? Okay. So what should I go ahead and add? No. Well, let's do the view first. Because I can already start to hit this guy, right? I've added this route, so all that's missing is a template, right? So let's go ahead and add that view. So we already have that working. Okay? The best development cycle that I've kind of come up with over my course of development is you want your code to be broken for as short amount of time as possible. Okay? When you're refactoring something, change a small something and hurry up and get it back to a working state as fast as you can. Okay? Focus on that one thing until it's working again, then move on to something else. Okay? Otherwise, you end up with your accounting homework. Okay? Which everybody knows how that turned out for everyone.
Yep.
That was bad. So, what view do I need to add?
Create.
Okay. How did I get mine to do what?
Come up with a little.
All I did was right click the.
I know, but mine comes up with like a blank page.
It could be because I might be running a different version of Sublime. That could be what it is. Because he's had Sublime on here a lot longer than we've been doing this class. So, anyway, well, now that I've got a template, I don't necessarily need anything here, right? It's just a blank page, though. Well, man, that's no fun. That doesn't do us any good. Now, remember, we've got stuff on the page, don't we? Because we've got stuff loading in from that application HTML file. But we're not yielding anything. Notice the body's completely empty. So, what should we put in here?
A cool form that people can input information into.
Well, lucky for us, I wrote a cool form earlier. I'm not that bad. Okay. So, first thing we're going to do is let's just go ahead and put our header here. And we'll say what this page is. This is, man, that's hard to look at and do this. New contact. Okay? That's what we're doing, right? I'll go ahead and put some sloppy little horizontal rule there. Okay. At least it doesn't look. Yeah, this still looks better than some of the old applications that went through here, so. Okay. Everybody got that?
Is that the HR thing?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
I was wondering
what that is. Yeah. It stands for horizontal rule. Okay. Okay. It is coming down. Wow.
Mm.
What direction do you come from?
I came from Natchitoches.
Oh, yeah.
Do you have the talking about the same magnitude as last time, or are they lighter?
Do I?
Are they talking about the same magnitude as last time, or is it going to be lighter?
I'm not sure. All right. Now that we've got a page working, let's go back to our contacts controller here. And what is it we should put in our new action? Okay. At contact what?
Equals big contact.
Equals
class contact.
The contact class, yes.
Dot new,
okay. So we're instantiating a new contact. It's completely void of data. There's no data in it at all. But we want to create one that the page can use. Okay? So what I'm going to do now is come over here, and inside of our Ruby code, we have visibility on that contact, don't we? Don't we? Okay. So, has anyone written a form before? Okay.
Yes.
You have? Good. All right, because we're going to use the Rails way of making a form. Okay? It's actually nicer because forms can get tricky to make, that you sometimes have to do some stuff, jump through some additional hoops to get it to work right with your server, especially if you have CSRF tokens like we do. Okay, but the general gist is kind of the same. Okay, we want to put a form on the page, right? So I'm going to say form for. Okay, and I want to generate a form for our contact. Okay, now this is a method.
Is it going to matter when you typed a new contact in line one, is it capitalized while contact is lowercase?
No, that's just plain text. It's just saying what's going to be rendered on the page.
Okay.
So the form for at contact is saying I want to generate a form for my variable contact, which we just instantiated, right? Okay. Kind of like a loop, this takes a block statement. All right. So, remember we define a block by saying do and we get our little variable over here sometimes depending on the method. In this case, the variable that we get back, it's not an iterator, it's the actual form. Okay? And then we call end over here. Okay? Now, can anybody guess what goes in between there?
In between those two.
Yes, you could cheat. Are you going to cheat, David?
No, I'm not going to do that. Yeah.
All right.
I feel like in the homework, if we did it this way, and then we changed it and added a underscore form view.
Yeah, I really know you're cheating now. Because that's what we're gonna do next. All right, so we have our block here, right? Okay. I want to an easy way to generate labels and fields with a Rails form is the form object that we get, F right there, actually gives us some methods to help us do that. And so if I say, okay, well, I want to take in a first name. Spiller, yeah, I did. Okay, I can just type that, and what that's going to do is that's going to generate a label for an attribute that's called first name on my contact object. And when I provide an input of the same name, it'll link the two. And I don't know if you've seen clicking precision before in browsers, but if you click the label, it'll automatically put your cursor like in the corresponding input field and stuff like that. So it'll automatically tie those together for you. So you don't have to do that yourself, which can be a pain if you forget sometimes. Okay, the other thing we need is a standard text field. Everybody got that? Okay. I will wait.
Thank you.
You're welcome. I'm blue, da-ba-dee-da-ba-da. No?
No.
Sorry.
Nobody ever needs to hear this.
Sorry. I'm so sorry. Played that track on loop for like 4 hours today while I was working.
Why?
Oh, that was totally a joke. that would never happen. What happened to your code? I lost my mind.
You see 5 pages of I'm blue.
Yeah. All right. So everybody got this now? All right. So if we come over here and we refresh our page. We now have a label and a text field, and there's the clicking focus like I was talking about. So you'll notice if we inspect this guy, let's look and see what this, okay, let's not inspect like that, let's do this. All right, so you'll see that Form 4 has filled in a lot of data for us, okay? All of this. So, it knows that the method, the verb we're trying to use is a post, okay? And it's specifying a character set, UTF-8. Y'all don't really need to worry about that right now. But the important part is the method and the action. The action is the URI that it's going to point to, right? Now, inside of here, this little guy. This little guy is a pain in the butt. All right? This is why I kind of wanted to use the Form 4 approach to this. Okay? You notice in our application controller, they give you this protect from forgery, okay? And it prevents CSRF attacks. Those are called CSRF attacks, okay? Essentially what that does is inside of your header, you get one of these guys, these meta tags, okay? It comes with a parameter, and it comes with a token, okay? What this does is it prevents people from automatically injecting some form and just spamming your server with it, because when your server gives someone this page, it's generating a token and saying, I will accept a request with a form submission if it contains this token. Okay? Someone can't just guess this token. I mean, it's pretty vast. So what it does is it automatically includes this token inside of a hidden text field inside of the form. Okay? You'll notice there the type is actually hidden and it does not appear anywhere on the page itself. But the data is there. And when the form is submitted, it's wrapped up with the form and the server authenticates against that token. If the token doesn't match or if it doesn't have a token, the server will throw an error and reject the request so that people can't tamper with your data. Every single time you load the page. Okay. So below that though, we have our standard label and our input field. Okay. Those are the ones we requested, right? Now I'm going to go ahead and copy this a couple times, these two lines. And we're going to call these last name and email. Okay, and I think that's all the properties we started this with, right? The contact had a first name, last name, and an email. Pretty sure. Oh, that's beautiful. Just gorgeous. Don't ever use these. But I don't feel like doing any styling for this example. Or, oh God, that's worse.
You gotta use two of them.
I don't know. All right. Do
with styling.
Oh, we could. I'm not gonna worry about styling though. Do I? HTML? Yeah. This right here?
Yes, just real. No, I'm not going to say that. He's going to make me tell him
how to write it. How do I write it?
Nope.
Close
the question.
Doesn't even hear, but how do I write it?
He wants to know how to line the labels up, or the text boxes.
That's a good homework assignment.
Yeah. There's a couple ways you could do it, really.
There's a lot of different ways.
Would you do it here, or would you?
No, you would do it in your style sheet, your CSS style sheet.
But you could do it here.
Yeah, but you don't.
That'd be bad practice.
That's right.
But not with styles. You could do it with a table. That's probably even worse than inline style. All
right, so we've got our fields on here, right? Our beautiful, beautiful fields. Okay, actually, that's bugging the crap out of me. I'm going to take these back out. Thought I was cleaning something up, but I'll just leave them in line. So we got our three fields. What am I missing?
A submit button,
right? I gotta have some way of sending it. And how do I do that, David?
Well, let me tell you.
He's just gonna look it up. It's pretty easy. All you have to do is call submit on the form.
Yeah.
Okay, it generates a button that has a type of submit. So we refresh here. Oops, did I forget my equal sign? I might have. Oh, I don't know how that character got there. I don't even know what that was.
I was trying to figure out what that was.
Yeah. All right, so we have a create contact. Okay. Now, we don't have any validation rules, I don't think, on the server. So I'm not going to worry about showing you how to put error messages on here yet. We'll save that for probably the next class. But we do want to go ahead and create one, right? Right?
Sure.
Okay. So if I provide some information, okay, and I try to submit this, I get no route. So where do I start, people? This is the third time we've done this today. So you need to remember it now. This is game time. So what route do I need to add?
You go to the Sublime file. First thing you do.
Okay, which Sublime file?
Go into the tag project.
That's helpful.
I know.
David?
Go into routes.
Routes. Sleepy Nick to the rescue. Okay, what do I add?
A submit page or something like that.
Close. Create. Okay. All right. Now what do I got to do? Added a comma and a create symbol. What's the next thing I need to do? Okay.
It needs its own method.
That's right. Now this one's going to be the first one that's actually a little bit different from what we've seen so far, correct? There's actually some logic that goes on in this one, right?
Logic.
Because we have a couple different cases, right? Either it successfully saves, or something's wrong and it doesn't successfully save, and we need to decide how to handle both cases, right? Oh, we will take a break as soon as we write this method.
Oh, you're asking us?
Yeah.
Well,
that's never a bad start in the controller. I'm sensing a pattern. Okay.
Dot
new.
Yeah.
New. Okay. Now what?
Parentheses.
Okay. Now what?
What?
It's I'm going to. Okay, let's read that just for a second.
Self equals self.
I'm going to create a contact.
All right, so that probably wasn't correct.
Probably not. I don't know. I think that might actually infinite loop. No, it wouldn't. No.
We need some sort of parameter in there.
We need parameters, right? We need the data from the form, correct?
Yes.
Yes.
We sure do.
We sure do. All right, so remember what I said last time about, well, if you're not sure what needs to happen, make up a method that does it for you and work around it. Okay? So let's pretend we have a method called save contact parameters. Okay? Well, the reason why I call it save contact parameters is because the purpose of this is to whitelist acceptable attributes. That way people can't give garbage data to your server. Okay? They can't provide an attribute blue jixipug for a contact that has no property called blue jixipug. So we only want to allow a specific set of attributes. What are the attributes we want to accept?
Safe ones.
Hmm?
The safe ones.
Yes, the safe ones. What are the safe ones? Oh my god.
Like that already exists.
The ones that already exist. Okay, I'll take that. So I'm going to create a private method, okay? And I'm going to call this method safe contact parameters. And inside this method, just like I said params ID before to get the ID, okay? This object has some additional functionality, okay? It's an actual object I can call dot something, you know, it's an object I can call methods on. I want to, and I know you're not going to immediately understand this, so that's okay, we'll explain it after the break. But I'm going to require a root of contact, okay? And then I'm going to say dot permit, and I'm going to permit each of the attributes that I want to accept. Okay? Make sense?
No.
Not really? Good.
I kind of
think so. I mean, those, it has to, for it to meet that parameter.
What this is saying it is requiring is a data payload that looks similar to this. So if it were in JSON, okay. So I'm not going to write all the attributes, but it's saying that I'm going to require something to have a root key of contact. Inside of that is my data payload with the attributes that I want to accept. So first name, last name, email. Those are not required. So this would be an acceptable payload for that method. Okay. Last name and email are permitted. They're not required. Contact is the only thing that's required there. So if I took this away and my data payload was just first name, that would blow up. The server would return an error. Okay? It would say bad request, literally. But we're doing things the right way, so we don't have to worry about that. Now, we only have a couple more lines to write in this. When I make a contact with properties and I want to put it in the database, how do I do that? We did it in the console the other day. It was dot something. Dot save, right? You were here that day. No. So, we're saving it. Now, what we didn't discuss when we were going over save is that it returns either true or false. Okay? If it's successful, it returns true. If the save fails, it returns false. Okay.
You don't need a question mark?
No, you don't have to have a question mark. It just so happens to return a true or a false. So what I can do with that, though, is I can say, all right, if the contact is able to save, do something. Otherwise, do something else, right?
Else error.
Right. Good?
Yep.
Okay. So inside of here, let's assume that it happens successfully.
Yeah.
All right. So I want to say redirect to, and I'm going to provide the contact. You know, we'll see that? Yay? Nay?
Yes.
Okay. Thank you. That's all for this example, except the error. So. What am I going to do if there's an error? I don't want them to go anywhere, right? I want the save to fail. So I want them to stay on the same page. So I'm just going to render new. Okay. So if I come to new here. We create that guy. It immediately redirects us to the show action for that contact we just created.
Nice to have a back or something on that page.
Yeah, we should add one. It's a good homework assignment.
We just love giving them ideas, I mean.
Yeah. But it's actually there in our list. It persisted to the database, right? Okay. We'll stop there for the break.
Can you show us what a fail looks like?
Actually, yeah, I can do that right quick. So, we're not displaying error messages on the page.
Okay.
But, let's give it a condition where it would fail. So, I want to say it's going to validate the presence of an email address. So, if an email doesn't exist, it's going to fail to save. So if I come in here and I say, and I don't provide an email, it just redirects us to the same page.
Why did it move the email to the bottom?
It just re-rendered it funny that way because we don't have a style sheet attached to the page.
All these new commands.
I told you. This is why we learned Ruby first. Because imagine trying to go back and learn what is Ruby and what's Rails now. It's ridiculous. But yeah, all those commands like redirect, all those are just controller methods, right? I mean, redirect to, render, those are methods on this contacts controller class. You're not doing anything really different or weird. You're just calling methods you didn't know were there. That's all. It'll get easier with time. So, but let's go ahead and take our break. So in about 5 minutes, we'll come back and we'll do a little bit more with this example, and then we'll start talking about our game.
Sorry. Is that going to be a Rails, or is it going to be console-based?
No, that's kind of why we wanted to keep it console, is so that you kept getting pushed into this object-oriented programming thing. And not just towards, ooh, let's make a Rails application, because if by the end of this all you can do is Rails, I'm going to be sad. So.